Welcome to another exciting episode of Knife Chats with Tobias, almost live. This episode was recorded in front of a live studio audience. Well, it was recorded in front of a live cat. Any case, hope you enjoy the show. Okay, welcome to another episode of Knife Chats Almost Live. I'm not sure if this is going to be at the very end of December or early January that it actually airs, because I am so backed up right now that I don't know what to do anymore. And that's one of the reasons why I'm doing this Knife Chats Live, or Almost Live, because there's a lot of really cool knives that I got recently that I just want to show you. And hopefully in the very near future, I will get around to doing some reviews on some of these knives. Now, some of the knives I will probably not be reviewing, but I still wanted to give them a real quick show because I really like them, and I think a lot of people will be kind of interested in them. And I think I'll start with these in the back here. This one I've shown before. This is by Frost, and it's just a little Steel Warrior kind of small hunter. They actually call it a Coon Hunter based off of raccoons. It's an unfortunate name these days, unfortunately. But I mentioned before that I really like this knife, and it's a really good fit for the hand, and or at least a really good fit for my hand. And I just, it's just a really cool little knife, and it does what it's supposed to do, which is cut little things. So I was really happy with it. And then I saw them advertising them on the old Cutlery Corner Network and decided to order a couple because I wanted to give one of them away. And they had it in a handle material that I really like. And so I went ahead and got it in ram's horn. But in order to get it in ram's horn, I also needed to buy one. And I think it was a buffalo horn or something like that. Yeah, it was in buffalo horn. That was the other choice that I had to get with this one. And, here's the ram's horn. And it's the nice one that's all kind of bumpy and everything. And I really just like ram's horn. And I wanted to get this knife to go in with the rest of the ram's horn knives I have. And it's still, you know, the 448 stainless steel. And knife still fits my hand well. And I think it might be, is it a little thinner? No, blade stock hasn't changed or anything. This is one of those knives that has been in the Frost lineup forever. And still a really well-made knife for a little fixed blade. And like I said, I just really like it. And the cool thing is they actually stepped up the sheath a little bit. The sheath is a little bit better than the older sheath. Doesn't really matter too much because I usually just toss these knives in the tackle box, or I just put them in a pocket because of how small they are. But I got it in ram's horn, and I really like the ram's horn. Now, like I mentioned, it was supposed to come in a buffalo horn, but when I placed the order, I got a phone call a couple days later, and they said they were all out of buffalo horn, and would it be all right to substitute it for ox horn? And it's like, I don't care, because the buffalo horn one was the one I was going to be giving away anyway. I wasn't interested in the buffalo horn. And so they sent me one in ox horn instead, and I got to tell you, I don't know if I want to give this away anymore. Because that ox horn looks really nice. I really like the way that looks as well. So it looks like the one that I'll probably end up giving away is the original green bone one I got. So either that or I might just get a couple more of these. Because this is one of those, it's an inexpensive knife. They go for about $8 or so if you're getting it from Cutlery Corner. And it's just a really nice little pocket knife, or a nice little fixed blade knife that you can throw in your pocket or that you can throw in your tackle box or just toss in your car for a little beater knife. And it, like I said, it just feels good in the hand. It's a really nice size for a small knife. You've got a blade. As you can see, it's not a really big blade. I know it doesn't matter. Most places, if it's a fixed blade knife, they don't want you to have it no matter what. But it's just a 2.5-inch blade with a cutting edge that's just over 2 inches, maybe 2 1/8 inches. But I don't know, just a really nice little pattern. They usually call it the Coon Hunter still, but it's probably my favorite little fixed blade out of the Frost Factory. I really like these little knives. I might have to get one in the Michael Prater lineup if there is one, because that's really my favorite little fixed blade knife by Frost. Most of their knives, fixed blade knives, I can't stand at all. But these little boogers, I really like those. Any case, let's move on to something a little more substantive and something that more people will be interested in. Or at least I think more people will be interested in. Found this one a little while ago. This is a Boker USA. I know it says Boker Tree Brand. And this is a little 493 pattern Barlow. These came out in the, they've been in the Boker lineup forever. This particular one, you can tell from the two pins here and the saw cut bone, and that it dates in the fact that it has brass liners on it. You can pretty much date this one to sometime in the early 1970s. That's when this one came out. Interesting though, if you notice here's the back bolster. Notice how, if we can get it to show. There's the back bolster. There's the front bolster. Notice anything significantly different? I'll give you a hint. The back bolster is not stamped nearly as cleanly as the front bolster. I don't know if that's from pocket wear or what. We're talking about a knife that's been around for 50 odd years or so, but still in really good shape. So I don't think whoever had this knife had used it very much. I'm starting to carry a Barlow now and then, and this is one of the Barlows that I'm going to be carrying. I kind of like it. It's a really cool one, and it's just one of those knives that I ran across. I'll go into a more detailed review of this one in the future, I hope, so I can explain how I knew that it was basically early 70s. Because there's an interesting way of dating these USA-made Boker Tree Band Barlows. So I'll talk about those in the near future. And this is another knife I want to eventually talk more about, and that is basically my boy's knife that I got from Slick Slicers, Eric over there in Scotland. And I want to talk about it and compare it to my Queen City prototype, which is also a boy's knife. So I will hopefully get around to doing a video on that one. This is the Arthur Wright one. And this one is definitely also going to be going in the pocket. So my in 2021, I am definitely going to be rotating my second knife in my pocket a little more often. Last year I carried my Dragonfly 2 in the pocket as my second knife for quite some time, but I'm going to be rotating next year. I'm going to be carrying Barlows. I'm also going to be carrying this boy's knife and a few other knives so they can get some pocket time and I can see how well they work. I might also end up rotating my large toothpick with a couple other large toothpicks in my collection, but I really want to compare these two knives to each other, and possibly these two knives have inspired me to consider getting a Great Eastern Cutlery boy's knife, so I can see three different boy's knives and talk about them. But this one here, I really just like the that blade. I like the spear blade on this one. I really dig it. So I will be talking more about that knife and this knife in the near future. By near future, sometime early in 2021. Now this knife, really this is a knife I'd rather ask Eric from Slick Slicers about, because he knows a lot more about Japanese friction folders than I do. I bought this one on a whim because I just saw it, whatever a daburu is, and I saw it, and it's got bamboo scales and a dragon on it. You can see there. I'll get the knife out in a second. But it's just a little friction folder, and I saw it, and it's like, it was dirt cheap, and I said, I'm going to go ahead and grab that. And so here we have it. It's got a dragon on the front there. You notice it's got two open rivets for the pivot points, and it's got two different blades on it. I don't know what kind of steel these are. Probably cheapo steel. It's a friction folder, and you basically have to hold down on that to make sure it doesn't fold up on you. But considering you're cutting down, it's not going to fold anyway because it's as far back as you can get it to go. And like a very pointy blade there. But if you notice, it is straight across the bottom there. The whole drop is from the top. So it's kind of like a Wharncliffe blade, but not really a Wharncliffe blade. And then on the other side, it's got, I don't know. I don't know what I would call that. A reverse tanto, I don't know. In any case, I just liked it. I saw it, looked kind of cool. It's got the fake forging going on there. And then, I don't know, it just kind of looked cool. After I got it, opened it, played with it a little bit, I thought, well, you know what? I would have liked it a whole lot better if it just had one blade. Either one of them, preferably probably this blade. I would have liked it much better if it was just a single blade knife, like so. And if that were the case, it would have been a lot skinnier and would have more potential for me to actually carry it. But just thought I would show it real quick and ask Slick Slicers if he knows anything about these knives. I never saw one before, but I really am not up on knives from Japan and China, or traditional knives out of Japan and China and stuff. This is one made in China, but it's supposed to be a copy of a Japanese folder. And I have been remiss in getting back to a knife that was given to me by Knife Detector. Now, this wasn't the one that he gave me. This is my Japanese hobo knife. I have a video on it and everything. But what Knife Detector gave me was its wee little baby. And he did a video on this already and talked about it a little bit. And I just thought, he said he was looking to give it away. And I said, hey, if you're throwing it some way, throw it my way. And I was more than willing to pay for it. But out of the kindness of his heart, he just gave it to me. And you can see, you can see the difference in them. Talk about a difference in size. Well, a little bit of a difference in the way they are lined up and everything. But talk about a big one. This one has no back tools. This one obviously has all those little back tools. But it has all sorts of little blades on the inside. One of them is very, very hard to open. And that is... the little bottle opener, or the little, it's a little can opener screwdriver here, or cap lifter screwdriver. That one is really hard to get open, but I don't care because it was just a slick little, cool little thing. And when you put the two of those next to each other, talk about really crazy. Look at the difference in size. That's the difference between 2.25 inches and 5 inches, basically, or 5.5 inches. What is this thing? Just 4.5 inches. 2.25 inches and 4.5 inches. That's the difference in size between these two knives. And I also have another one of those little ones, a little wee knife. I don't know what these things are for. I know they are functional, and I do know one thing, and that is that the blades... probably 420 steel and such, but they can get sharpened and they will cut. And this one even has, if I can get to it, a little pair of scissors, and these scissors actually will cut. But let me show you something else about the size of the spoon on here. But you see the size of this spoon. This is a tablespoon. This thing, I don't know what it is, but let's compare it to a couple other hobos that I have in my collection and the difference in size of the spoons. Okay, let's get the spoon opened up. So that's the size of the spoon here. And here's the spoon on the Coleman hobo knife that you can usually find at Target and such places. Notice the difference in sizes. And here's the spoon. This one is on an Ocoee River copy of the Case Trapper style hobo. And I do not recommend this knife because it falls apart all the time because of the way it locks. It just, you see it falling apart in my hand. So, but there's the size of the difference in the size of the spoon. So even the smaller spoons that you run across, this thing is wee. We're talking about a third or half the size of your typical spoon on these hobo knives. Here's the K-bar. I will recommend the K-bar over the one by Ocoee River because it stays locked. Notice the difference in the size of the spoon. So yeah, if you're trying to if you need to take a half a teaspoon of really nasty medicine, this is probably the spoon you want to use. But this is actually an actual full teaspoon. Matter of fact, let's show this spoon compared to your typical plastic spoon, which is would be the obvious choice to carry out in the woods as opposed to that little spoon. And so here we go, a typical plastic spoon, and you see the difference in size. And the plastic spoon is also bigger than most of the other hobo spoons out there until you get to the old 5-inch or 4.5-inch hobos out of Japan. Then this spoon is much bigger. And I tell you what, this is basically the kind of plastic spoon that came with sea rations when I was in the Army. And typically what you would do when you're out in the field is you just lick your spoon off, stick it in your pocket, and you would keep that spoon for an entire 2 or 3 weeks. So a plastic spoon while camping really fills the bill. But what comes in handy on these things is the fork, which you can actually poke things with and hold it like a piece of hot dog or sausage or something. And that's where even this little fork like this really comes in handy. And like I said, with these kind of forks, if you got like a tick or something, you can press down on either side of the tick and push through until you pop the tick out, and then put a little disinfectant on your hand and you're good to go. So that's the good thing about a fork like this. You can remove ticks, and you can also eat chunks of meat and potato and everything else with it. But this spoon, yeah, I would not recommend this knife for the spoon, but come on, it's a cute little thing. What will it be when it grows up? Okay, let's move on to something else and get all this out of the way. Before I go on, I also got, well, one of these knives I got from Knife Detector. He sent it along with that little hobo knife, and it's a Camp Buddy knife. Now, the Camp Buddy knives were at one time made by Camillus. I know quite a bit more about it, but I can't remember it off the top of my head. Let's see if this is the one that he sent me. Yeah, this is the one that was sent to me by a Knife Detector. He sent me a Camp Buddy USA, and I think he talked about this knife on his channel at one time. And the weird thing about these knives is they got this screwdriver end over here, and it's just got this little divot cut out on the end there. There's no real cap lifter to it because, well, this is actually for stripping wire and stuff like that, and also stripping bark off of twigs and things of that nature. And then obviously a little screwdriver or pry, because the can opener on this end also doubles as a cap lifter. So you can actually open a bottle with this end. And yes, I have actually tried it, and it definitely does work. The can opener actually works as a bottle opener too. So it actually has a few more functions than your typical camp knife, because you can use this for stripping bark or for stripping wire. Now the other version of the Camp Buddy, same exact knife. Blades will look a little bit different, but not much different. You notice the difference there. And then the can opener cap lifter is also slightly different, a little smaller, a little slimmer. But both of these will actually open bottles as well as cans. And the way you can tell the difference, well, I'm not sure if it's really a difference or not, or if it's just a difference between these two knives. But one of them is stamped Thornton USA, and the other one was stamped Camp Buddy USA. Most people assume that the ones that are stamped Camp Buddy USA were made by Camillus. And that may be true, but the thing is that one time Thornton was also a Camillus brand. So there's a lot that goes into this, because Thornton also ended up being owned by somebody else at one time. So any case, there's the your Camp Buddy names. And the interesting thing about Camp Buddy, regardless of if it was made by Thornton, Camillus, or anyone else, the Camp Buddy name is a registered trademark for Camillus, and remained a registered trademark for Camillus all the way up until 2007, when Camillus closed, even though the knives are not made that long. So if it's stamped Camp Buddy, most likely it was made by Camillus, regardless of what the tank stamp says. Let's move on to something else. This is my Betsy Ross Tinker by, you know, Victorinox, a Swiss Army knife. And I got this at Smoky Mountain Knife Works when I was there in the summer. I think I might have already shown this, but I really like this knife. It looks really great. The only thing that would have been better, as far as I'm concerned with this knife, is if it would have been a Spartan or a Camper or something else. But it seems like every Smoky Mountain Knife Works special edition knife like this always comes out on a Tinker frame. And, well, no offense to SMKW, but I'm just a little tired of collecting Tinkers. So this very well might be the last 91 millimeter Tinker I buy, regardless of what they put on the frame. The scales, I'm not too concerned anymore. I'm tired of Tinkers. I want to see 91 millimeter Victorinox knives doing something else coming out of SMKW. I passed on a couple already, simply because it was a Tinker. I'm tired of Tinkers. I don't know, other people probably love the Tinker, and they get them all the time. If these were on Spartan frames, I'd be picking them up right and left. I have no problem with the Spartan frame, but I just, the Tinker does nothing for me. So if it's a, even with the cool scales and everything, I just can't see myself picking up any more Tinkers. It's going to have to be something really, really special for me to consider picking up a Tinker. And I don't care if it's from Smoky Mountain Knife Works, Swiss Knife Shop, or any DLT Trading or whatever. I'm sick of Tinkers. You put those scales on some other frame, and then I might be interested in it. On the other hand, let's talk about classic SDs. But before we go to the classic SDs, let me show you a couple of my out the front knives. Matter of fact, it's the only two out the front knives I got. This is the first one. It's a South Korean gravity knife that is a copy of the old German paratrooper's knife. And well, it's just a gravity knife, so the blade just drops out and it'll lock in place. You push this little lever and it drops back in. And it works by gravity. There is no spring loading or anything else in it. And that is, that's the one out the front knife I have. But let me show you the one that gets the most use, and it is probably my favorite OTF knife of all time. and very small, easy to conceal, and well, here it is. It's controlled by a button. Look at that, and it locks. It doesn't go in unless you push the button down, and then you can pull it back. That's my favorite OTF right there. And the reason I'm showing it to you is because I got another Victorinox Classic SD. This one is out of SMKW, and it is the Trash Panda. And I like raccoons, so that's why I had to get it. And, well, let's get this thing open and see how well that works with my OTF. I bet you most people thought they would never see an OTF on this channel. But, yep, I got one. And it works. Well, it sort of works. There we go. Let's get out my Trash Panda. And fortunately, most of the Tinker versions that SMKW comes out with, they also come out in a Classic SD. So that's what I'm going to have to do for now, and is I'm just going to wait until the Classic SD comes out, because the Classic SDs are usually, well, $5-6 cheaper, and I actually collect Classic SDs. And there you have it. Got the banana peel on the back and raccoon prints. And it's a nice light blue. I thought these were white when I was first looking at it in the store. Or online, rather. And you notice the raccoon? Let's see if we can see that. It's got bananas in each hand like they're guns or something. And he's hopping out of the garbage can. That is just so cool. I really like that. And glad I picked that up. But I also got another Classic SD, which is also pretty cool. And not from Smoky Mountain Knife Works and not from a knife store in general. But it's still pretty cool. Okay, let me get rid of this plastic spoon. We don't need that. And this other one, my other Classic SD, comes in this really nice box. I like it. And I don't know how many people have seen this one before, but is it ever cool? It is from Duluth Trading Company. And that's not that Duluth. It's the one that sells all those fire hose pants and everything. And it is their Angry Beaver Classic SD. And look at that. It looks like a fire hose or something in the brown covering and everything. It's an ABS thing. And it's got the Angry Beaver logo on there. They sent the knife along with an Angry Beaver sticker, which was pretty cool, too. So that's on my sticker board now. But otherwise, it's just your Classic SD. But I saw that one, and it was on sale. And, man, I just said, got to have that one. Who doesn't want an Angry Beaver? So there you go. And they're still out there. They go for like 20 bucks or so. But the Duluth Trading Company Angry Beaver Classic SD. I saw that and it's like, man, I gotta have that one. So, got a Trash Panda and an Angry Beaver. And talk about a really nice box. I really like that box. Let's move on to a couple other knives. Got another knife out of Spain. This one says Teja Acero Inox. And if you can see from the drawing there, you kind of know what it is. And here we have it. They say this is olive wood. I'm questioning that, but it's such a really cool knife. And it is, well, there you go. 5 1/4 inches closed. And let's just look at that blade on here. Notice there's no nasty nail nick to ruin the lines of the knife. Listen to this lockup. Was that ever positive? Look at that. Is that, that's not a beautiful knife. Yeah, if you're into powder horns, this is really a good one. It's stainless steel throughout. Well, you got brass pins on there. And it's got the external back spring. See how it's actually held in with the rivets right here. And then you've got the lever for closing. So you push forward on the lever, and it will break open the blade, and you can close it. This cannot be flicked open, and it doesn't ratchet around or anything, but it has the that lever lock, which is so cool. And I've been looking for one of those, and it's going to look really good in the collection. If you're familiar, I also have something similar by Kudamin, and that's this one here with the ring that you pull up on. But you notice the difference in the construction of the two knives. This one has the stainless steel bolster up front to give it a little more strength and everything. The Kudamin definitely looks nicer in my book, but you can see which one is a little more functional and a little more easy to use. Fortunately, neither one of them bothered to put on nail nicks in the blade. And the Kudamin's a little smaller, but lockup is still just as strong. But you open this one by pulling up on the ring, which is a little more difficult than using the lever. And this is obviously not my only lever. Well, it's really a lever unlock, but or a lever lock. But this one is really nice. And yeah, I got a feeling this one's going to have a little pocket time. Not too much, because pretty much illegal to carry where I live. But that lock is so nice. So got that one. And once again, supposed to be in olive wood. I have my doubts. I'm going to have to check it out a little bit, but it is definitely a pretty knife and I really like it. Okay, as long as we're in the Powderhorn family, let me show you my latest toothpick that I picked up. Well, it's by Chat & Morgan. And it was still readily available at a online retailer, even though according to the blade stamp, this is from 2010. This is a file and wire tested. And well, let's take a look at it. Comes in a classic worm groove bone handle. Not my favorite jigging pattern, but because of how big and deep it is, but it does kind of look nice on this knife. And I do like the coloring on it, and I also like how well it is polished. You've got a triple ringed powder horn, and then you've got a double ringed and pinched upper bolster here. Hold on, somebody wants to talk. Okay, kitty, say hi to everybody. You want to say hi? You want to go get some food? Is that it? You know I'm trying to work, so you had to come by and get your head scratched, right? All right, I got to get back to work, all right? You want to say bye to everybody? Bye-bye. Kitty's got to go. Yeah, her bowl wasn't overflowing, so I think she thought she was going to starve to death. In any case, here we are back with the Chat & Morgan triple ring powder horn bolster, then two spaced rings on the top here with a nice pinch at the top of the bolster, Chat & Morgan shield, and then brass liners and stuff. I'll go into more detail on this knife later because I do intend to do a full review of it, but thought I would definitely show it now. And as you can see here, 5.5 inches closed, not your usual five. It's 5.5 inches closed. And the overall length of this knife when open is 10 inches. So it's a nice big one. And definitely something that's going to see some pocket time. Really beautiful lines going on with it. And nice and sturdy. I really like it. And this is one of the old Queen Maid Chat & Morgan knives. So like I said, from what I saw in the on the blade etch here, is it there or on the other side? Somewhere in there it says 2010. We'll talk about it later. In any case, got that knife to talk about in the beginning of January, and then a couple more knives that I want to talk about in the beginning of January, which are by the later Queen or Queen City. These are under the SMKW trademark. And I think a lot of people have already mentioned these. These are the new ones that are in black pearl instead of the abalone. So they're still made in China. And I picked these up specifically because I've got quite a few black pearl knives already by Rough Rider. And I just wanted to throw those in with it. So I went ahead and picked up the little Cub Lockback in the Black Pearl, and that really does look nice. And then the other one I picked up is the little Mini Canoe, which you see here also, if I can get it out of the box. Here we go. A little Mini Canoe, and the build and workmanship on these is pretty dang good. Pretty happy with it. Yeah. Once again, Black Pearl at $24.95 a piece. So I'm pretty happy with those, and I kind of like those, and I will do a more full review on those in the near future too. Of course, they don't hold a candle to the old Chat and Morgan toothpick. Oh, and I guess to wrap things up here, I thought I would show you something that's in my collection that you probably won't see anywhere else, and that is a fish knife. Well, it's a fish scabbard for a fish knife. A little bit long there. But basically, I bought this fish knife with the white handle. I don't have to take it out of there. Actually, bought this knife off of eBay from a trusted seller, very much a trusted seller, because I bought this from Steve Koontz from the old Knives Live TV show. This knife was at one time in his collection. Well, I wouldn't say it was in his collection. It was a knife that he had that he was selling. It came with a sheath that he mentioned it. It was already dry rotted and mildewed and falling apart. So the sheath was totally worthless. The only thing that was worthwhile on the whole sheath was actually the band here. And so I thought, well, what the heck? Let's take some wood and carve a sheath for it. And that's what I did. I took different slabs of wood, pressed and glued them together, made the backing for it. I noticed there's enough space there so for the thickness of the handle. And put a couple pieces of wood on the side here. It's all glued together. And by doing it that way, the bottom of the sheath is open, or actually scabbard is open, so that if you put the knife in there and it's all wet, it will drain. Water will just run out the bottom. And then I carved little divots in it, and then drew in the lines in it and everything, and then I painted the sheath various shades of green and yellow and everything to kind of make it look like a fish. And you see the fish tail for the back part of it here. And so there's my fish scabbard for my fish knife, an old colonial. And I don't know, I thought it was pretty cool. And then just to finish it all off, I put some tackle tape on the back side of it, so, well, you can measure, well, basically up to 10 inches of fish on there, and then copying over and over and over. So 5 inches almost, 8 inches closer, 12 inches nice catch, 16 trophy, and 18 inches whale. So the closest I can get is a probably a nice catch on there, which is really about what I get with it. But in any case, figured what the heck, I would break that out and show it in here too. And it was just a kind of a fun, goofy project, you know. So if you got one of those fixed blade knives and it doesn't have a sheath, you can always consider trying to make something out of wood. Wood is easy to work with. Easier to work with than leather, matter of fact. And when you're talking about carving a fish, how accurate do you really need to get? Anyway, with that said, I think I'm going to wrap this episode of Knife Chats Live, almost live, up. And, well, I'll talk to you again soon. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed the show.
And that brings us to the conclusion of another exciting episode of Knife Chats with Tobias, almost live. If you liked what you saw, give us that thumbs up and leave us a comment. We always like to hear from you here at Knife Chats with Tobias. And don't forget to subscribe and ring that notification bell so you'll know when the next exciting episode of Knife Chats with Tobias is up and running. But thanks again, and we'll see you soon.